So I'll ask the first question to Ms. Aline. I just wanted to find out if there are, let's say, programs or guidelines for the immersion of teachers as part of an industry-academe collaboration, because it was identified that one of the gaps was like the amount of money spent to for retooling of, let's say, graduates. So, and it has been cited that one factor actually is also the quality of the teachers and the knowledge and exposure of the teachers in the industry. So are there current programs of CHED or as part of this new initiative that you rolled out?
Yes, actually as early as 2004, CHED had faculty development programs, and then this was picked up also by the K-12 implementation and development programs. Right now, currently discussions on the development of tourism education actually included, of course, development programs for students, for faculty, and of course for research. So it's part of the components that they'd like to take off perhaps in the next 3 years. So very critical would be the inputs of the faculty on what they really want to do and how CHED can help them and what could be programs crafted. And also the immersion with industry is very important, essential, because while we have revised the curriculum, we have to help this faculty be able to update themselves so that they can be exposed to what the industry is doing. And this is one of those initiatives perhaps outside of the government sector that is much appreciated, I think.
Especially in the area of innovation and the technologies, because we have to admit that, of course, there are some faculty who are also challenged in terms of exposure to new ways of doing things. And sometimes the students learn faster, and actually students are more techie savvy than the teachers. So it's really like a challenge, not just in the classroom, but also outside. Yeah. Now, Ms. Maria Isabel, I wanted to ask actually two questions about the TESDA's program. Do you have new skills and competencies identified for travel and tourism in response to the demands of this new travel space, as discussed by Aileen, Timothy, and also by Andy in the first panel?
Actually, right now. So right now po, we are still having this, what we call the action programming under the Bayan Academy project, wherein we are identifying the skills requirements. So hopefully po, within the years, we will come up with what are the skills requirements needed in preparation for this fourth industrial revolution po. So we have a consultation with Professor Morato po. So the planning office, the one conducting this research or action program.
Yes, most especially I think in the presentations in the first panel, there were like identified new career opportunities and even new roles. So we hope that could be used also as inputs your ongoing program with Bayan Academy.
And also that consultation about the action programming, we have the Tourism Industry Report Foundation incorporated as one of the members.
I see. And so, then another question, in terms of this membership in your ongoing dialogue between private sector and local government units, I just noticed that the membership is confined to some associations. Is there like possibility of opening up to, you know, other really private sector entities or even enterprises who have really that capability to help you craft the skills and the competencies needed?
One of the slides shows that we are encouraging the enterprise-based training program as the modality for the Tibet delivery. So it means to say we are encouraging the private companies or the enterprises who are willing to offer the Tibet programs. So that's one way of having to become a member of the Tibet sector through TESDA po. So the membership is open to all po. So we do not limit our. Actually, there is an office in charge, the planning
the partnership linkages office, the one in charge in these activities. So we are encouraging industry associations and private companies to be recognized as the TESDAS partners in the delivery of TESDAS programs. So like for example, one of the active industry association po is the TID people. So for the construction, we have this Philippine Constructors Association. We also have this for the automotive, the CAMPI. So all of all the different sectors are being involved in the TESDA programs.
But is there a possibility that it won't be just limited to associations, like even specific enterprises can actually join?
Yes, it is not limited to industry associations because very few who have this established industry association. I think the one who is only surviving is the tipping about as mentioned. So, yun po. So we are not limiting to the industry associations.
Thank you, Ms. Isabel. JP, you discussed actually the three forms of human wealth, right? So the social capital, you have the human capital, and then the knowledge capital. Now, I wanted to ask if, let's say, you have programs or initiatives that that could actually be tapped by our members here from the audience in terms of really expanding our base, particularly of the knowledge capital that you mentioned to be one of the biggest gaps right now in our human resource capacity.
Now, for programs to enhance the creation of knowledge, I mean, universities or higher educations can actually invest on their people and their faculty to participate in research writing workshops so that they get to learn how it is to actually do research that will push the frontiers of knowledge. It's really for, okay, it may sound so academic, but academic research would actually tell you how new things can be done. And it can only be learned straight from those people who do it, who are actually into offering these kinds of research workshops. It has to be. Although it may sound impractical, academic research sounds impractical, but as far as creation of knowledge capital is concerned, it is the way to go. And there are a lot of research workshops that are available for faculties. There are a lot of research databases that can be used by faculty, that can be tapped by faculty, a lot of institutions offering such programs so that we all together we can start building. I mean, it's not automatic, but together we can, as early as now, we can start building the pool of researchers that can actually contribute to the creation of knowledge capital.
Actually, I noticed in the presentation of, in the video of Our Lady of Fatima University, you highlighted actually an impact factor for the research works that have been produced, if I'm not mistaken, by your faculty here. So, congratulations. I think I saw quite a high number for that. Do you have any questions? Yes, please. Please state your name and your organizational affiliation.
Hello, I want more to be remembered by my question. So anyway, so actually that's a good move from the academic. So I'm very happy with this because I'm a Chedd scholar, my dissertation is about TESDA, and I'm an academician slash researcher. Sir, thank you very much for your recommendation. But thing is, the academic institution is very supportive. Actually, they give a lot of budget, chunk of it for the for research. But it so happened that it's really hard to persuade faculty members specifically coming from our field to do research. Sorry for this, ah. Kaya nga ako nag-HRM or nag-tourism, tapos mag-research ako. That's the common thing that we hear. But a lack of support from Chedd, even from the academic institutions, even the higher management are very supportive. But how are you going to persuade faculty members on how to do publish? Not presentation, but to publish. Thank you, sir.
In most academic institutions, they provide incentives. You do have, and how much are we talking about here? 5 million per publication? No, the straightforward approach here is through monetary incentive. That's given. But second is, maybe for me, this is just my opinion, but do you want to be replaced by technology? Of course not. Of course not. So you do research. I mean, this again an opinion, but doing research, I understand because the time to do teaching and the time to do research is actually overlapping with each other, right? And as faculty, the primary mandate is not really to research, but rather to teach. Am I right?
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
Yeah, but that's why a lot of universities actually attack this through incentives, right? And to encourage faculty to do research, research collaboration is an option wherein different universities can actually work together to publish and share the necessary incentives accompanying it. Yes, sir.
Sorry, sir. Sir, do you recommend a publish or perish approach?
The publish or perish approach, that's very tricky. Huh? Publish or perish, because I would like to approach it this way. You have to train the faculty first. And in training the faculty, they will get the gist, the hang of doing research. Because I do not agree that you just let the faculty publish without the necessary tools or retooling. I guess, from my end, we can start with training first and see the reception of faculties to it. Because in training, learning from those who really publish, I still believe in getting inspiration from these people who actually do publish, get incentives, and actually see their names on print. Because when I was a new faculty before, 10 years ago, I was not into research, but then as a young faculty, seeing my name on print was actually very motivating. It's just looking for that quote-unquote silver lining in doing publication. And for me, my opinion on that is seeing your name on print is enough motivation for me to continue doing research. And being in the academy, I think that is one of the things that we should be doing in expanding knowledge.
Thank you, JP. Yes, Ms. Aline.
Perhaps can I just add a little? I think the challenge is, I think I want to go back with Ma'am Aline, is the passion. The passion to actually master your craft. If you're a faculty and you get this checklist of tools to develop your students, that should not be enough as a fulfillment to be a really responsive faculty dedicated to train these students. Congratulations to all of those who are undergoing their graduate studies, which including you, congratulations. For other fields, there are incentives for deloading, incentives for publication, and even sometimes full-time study. So research, passion for research should come really from within the faculty. And at the same time, maybe some outlet would be partnership with industry so that we can determine what are the areas that need to be studied on, expand on, sites to be developed, and among other approaches. It might be different in the case of tourism kasi I'm more familiar with the science researchers. Pero it's mastering the tourism sector. How do we move it forward if you don't do research? How do we know that technology in Singapore might not work in the Philippines? But there might be another way, another technology, another innovation, another tourism package that's only suited for Philippines. You cannot do that if you don't do research. So yun lang. Perhaps it's a challenge to the HEIs to challenge their faculty or for JET to compel the faculty. I don't know, that's in the future yet. Pero yun.
Okay, thank you for your responses to that very challenging question. Okay, any other questions from the floor? From the back? Yeah, we have representatives from other HEIs here. Maybe you'd like to ask some questions about the CHED and test the program, some enlightenment maybe. they've said it all, so they already identified everything. Yes, Aileen.
No, siguro just ano, the endeavor of the Tourism Knowledge Center is really to have a big advocacy on research. It's one of the things that we've started. That's why we also have a Tourism Knowledge Center Review Committee, because we are advocating research. And if you go to the website of TKC, of the Tourism Knowledge Center, kaya nga gusto rin namin, we're trying to gather the sets of data from the different national government agencies and the local government units para yung data center namin, nandun na yung data. Because what we see is that 80% of the time is spent looking for the data. So we're hoping that with this data center, which we hope will come live by the end of quarter four, that the data is available so that you can spend time on analysis. Ang nakita kasi ng review committee where JP and Twinkle are part of is that there are several research papers pero hindi pumapasa sa marka, so to speak. Because, yun nga, nakulangan ng time sa analysis. So there's two parts to the attitude here. One is, ang hirap maghanap ng data, so okay na lang, basta bahala na. The second is, sige na, para lang may maipasa na. So what we're trying to encourage here is for the mindset to change then, and the frustration on your ends, not to be on the data gathering, but rather we have a richer output because there is a better analysis portion. So that's where Raja Travel and the advocates of the research are here also to help. So that's why we're going to the different sources of data. So we hope that that can also assist you and not be frustrated in what you're doing so that you can also change your mindset in doing your researches.
Thank you, Aileen. Okay, so if you don't have any more questions, I'd like to thank our panelists, Ms. Aline, Ms. Maria Isabel, and Dr. Rivera for their time. Thank you very much.